So the YouTube algorithm says robot arm servo robot arm servo motor. It's a popular topic. I'm sure we've all searched it. Any nerd that wants to build a robot. Robot arm a servo motor. Robot arm a servo motor. This is a wearable, so let me put this on real quick. Let's demo it. Okay. Let's turn this guy on. So I've got a little controller in my hand here, and I can control one arm. Where am I going? There we go. First arm section. Second arm section. Right. Robot arm servo motor. Kind of like cool dystopian Mad Max arm extension. Like my knockoff RoboCop. Okay. So. Let me talk about this thing for a minute. This is, there's a ton of laser cut parts here. They wouldn't need to be laser cut. You could cut a lot of these things, honestly, by hand and just use a drill, right? So don't be intimidated by all the little holes. This is my own nerdy thing. But it does have two standard hobby servos and a little joystick controller. Let's start with that, actually. Let's start with this part. So you work with what you got, and you can get these, right? Standard hobby servo. This is actually an analog servo, isn't it? I think so. But I tend to use digital servos for a lot of these things. Hobby servo, standard. Joystick on a little circuit board. They sell this, they call it a PS2 joystick, but it's just a basic analog joystick. It does have a click. I tend not to use that. Usually I'm just using the X and Y. Especially for a thing like this, that wearable, it's a first arm section, second arm section, not exactly an intuitive interface. It's like a poor UX choice, but I don't know, I like it. It's just derpy enough. So again, working with what you have, standard hobby servos, there's two of them. I built it on top of a carpal tunnel wrist brace. Build a little box. You always need to build a little box. You got to have a place to put stuff like a battery. They're always huge. They're always heavy. Where are you going to put it? This is a 7.2 volt nickel metal hydride. It's like a RC car battery. Little switch. Turn on off. Circuit board. So not only does it hold the battery and the switch, but it also and also creates a place to connect the arm and everything to mount things. Also has a circuit board. I'm using a breadboard here. Be aware, you know, breadboards are trash, right? The stuff just tends to fall out, but they're fast. But I'm also pretty sloppy. I like to just grab this thing. So use some hot glue. Put some hot glue on the board where the plug meets and just like, you know, give it a good solid heel. If you work it hard enough, it's going to snap off anyway. So the nice thing about hot glue is that you can peel it off and still change things. But if you glue this stuff down so that it doesn't move, then you're not going to accidentally unplug something. And it's kind of like halfway towards a proto board. And it's often, for me, just like so much faster. Right? By the time you start cutting wires to solder, I'd rather just design a custom PCB. Wait a minute. I'll show you that. That's where I ended up. But you start here, right? Because it lets you work things out. So breadboard, all the electrical connections. So these servos have wires coming down to meet up on the board. They're connected to voltage regulators, and it's controlled by an Arduino Nano. So I can't recommend using a couple of buck converters like this, just putting in some kind of voltage regulation. I can't recommend it enough. First of all, you can actually work with motors of any kind of reasonable size because you can give them the power they need. It also creates kind of like an electrical isolation so that the noisiness from these motors, because motors generate a lot of electrical noise, and so they will splash voltage back onto the control circuitry. Put some voltage regulators in there, you create like kind of like a little wall for that. If the motors stall out and draw too much current, the Arduino will fall into like a hardware reset. If you use voltage regulators, that's not going to happen typically, because the voltage regulator will bottom out, and then that will cut power to the motor, but the Arduino still has power, and it's got its own voltage regulator. So, and there's a lot going on in this little thing. it gave me an opportunity to learn a bunch of concepts and kind of make little corrections, and it's fun to play with. So, and it's pretty cheap, right? This is like a pretty dirt cheap build right here. But those little hobby servos, so like on the mechanics side, one more thing. This hobby servo is driving a linkage that's connected to this arm, right? So this arm moves back and forth, and all the load is on this bolt right here. Then I did a no-no, but who cares? Because I was, you know, being lazy, essentially, and just moving forward. I attached a servo here to the end of this arm, but now this arm has to carry the weight of this motor. So as it moves back and forth, it's constantly throwing this weight back and forth. This end arm here is connected directly to that servo. So this servo is carrying the weight of this arm, just kind of straight up. And it has no support, so all the abuse that this arm takes goes straight through the shaft of that thing. This arm here, at least it's bolted to the frame, so that some of that gets eaten up by the box, right? It's not hitting this thing directly. But definitely want to get the weight off of this arm. So, on that point, my next kind of step was to head in this direction. This is the same thing. It's a two-part robot arm. It's a lot bigger, obviously. Not a lot more power requirements. It's running on a 12-volt battery, and it has its own control circuits, but it's kind of similar to the other one. It's just like a bigger brother of that. Let me demo this real quick. This is also a wearable. It's bigger, though. You gotta be careful. It's got like more like a vest-style strap. Put it on. There we go. Okay. And like this, and like that, right? So let's turn this guy on. It's got a front arm section there. Looks like the other one. It's got two arm sections. It's got a back arm controlling it with simple joysticks. Please don't hurt me. Do be careful when you build a robot arm that's big enough. But careful. That is long enough to hit you in places you don't want it to. So let's talk about how this thing is built. You can see though, it's, you know, it's fine. It'll put up with a beating, and it's good. It's made for performance. It's not super strong, but it's strong enough to carry its own weight and to move at a rate that still creates something interesting. Let's get into this guy. Okay, so like I said, it's got a 12-volt battery this time, but again, a box to put the battery in and also to mount the circuit board. Here I'm using a custom PCB. I'm not just using a breadboard. I've got my little branding there for the framework. This you can download, the software framework. I have not published any of the hardware designs. Frankly, like I have my plate is full just trying to even make this stuff work. And be aware that doing robotics is not for the faint of heart, right? So as you get into building stuff, prepare yourself for some long hauls as you diagnose or design certain kinds of systems just to get them working without falling apart. At some point, I'd love to publish all this stuff so you could just download this stuff and print it one fine day when I have time. This has got two motors, so two servos. They're custom servos. So these are servos, but they're not like hobby servos, right? The big DC gear motors that I bought. So let's just to do this bit. Right, here's your standard hobby servo. Here's the DC gear motor I'm using. Both bought off Amazon, both pretty cheap. This has three wires, right? Two wires to power it, one wire for the signal. This just has two wires. It's just a motor. So however you're gonna control this thing, you have to provide that yourself. Enter the custom servo. Right, this gives me the power of a big cheap DC gear motor, but then I can make it smart. This hub makes this motor smart, which means that it acts like a servo. It's got an encoder inside, which helps me figure out the position and tell it where to go. On top of this custom servo, I've got this pulley and then a steel drive cable that drives another pulley. And let's just demo this thing. Hold on, I'm getting the wires kind of tangled up there. Just a minute. Okay. Boop. So when that's a lot. So that's to hold there. Okay, thank you. So when I run this, the back motor section, you can see that pulley turns and twists this housing here. And then when I move the other motor, just that pulley runs. And that drives that other pulley and moves down there. So what I've done here is kept the weight of the motors off of the arm, right? All of this is the arm. It has no motors on it. This motor is the closest to being on the arm, but it's actually on the joint. So this motor here rotates when the arm moves and is rotated by this motor, but it is not in flight. It's not on the arm, and the arm, when the arm moves, it doesn't have to carry the weight of either of the motors. On an earlier version, I put this motor kind of like on the arm, but towards the back. This is way better. These motors don't contribute to the load of the arm at all. You get all the power out of the motor, get the most power out of the arm you possibly can by keeping the motors off. You do have to use something more like this. I decided to go with pulleys. These steel cables, this is great, right? This is stainless steel cable. It's got like a 100-pound test. It's way more powerful than the robot. The only thing I'd actually want to be really worried about here is myself. And if I make this more powerful, I do need to be aware of something like this. This is a pinching hazard, right? And if this motor was really powerful, like bigger, it could do me damage. It could take the end of my finger off. So beware when you build robots that you're not making something that you can actually hurt yourself with. This will whack me either in the head or other body parts. And it's pretty uncomfortable, right? It's strong enough that it hurts. I don't want to keep doing it. And if it was more powerful, it could actually really hurt me. At 12 volts, I'm safe. But do be aware of that as you're building these things, because it, it only takes once. So two servos driving a big robot arm using steel drive cables gives me like a huge, it lets me build it much bigger and more theatrically and still get some decent power out of it. I'm still using joysticks to control it. So this time, joystick. The other one had the single joystick, and this time I decided to go with the double. So I'm not using the side-to-side motion of this joystick. I'm only using the up-and-down motion. One joystick moves the first motor. The other joystick moves the second motor. So I decided to design a little controller housing. I have another video where I talk about how I approach a process like this to do the smooth modeling. This is 3D printed. You will have to also deal with mounting. So inside, you can see I've got my little PS2 joystick in there, right? With the little recessed stumps there to put it in the right position so that it sticks up just here. That was kind of tricky. And it'll take you a minute to figure that out. Again, I haven't had the time to publish any of those things, but it's relatively straightforward because it really just the joystick controls the motor. The software would probably be one of the hardest things. You're welcome to go check that out. I've got a GitHub repo, Powder of Life, where you can download that stuff. Incidentally, making videos like this makes me really anxious. I'm just trying to get better at it. So like, subscribe, please. And even more so, leave me a comment. If there's something you're interested in, or if there's something I need to go into in depth on, I'm happy to make another video on that. But drop me a line, and I'll see you next time.